I want to start this lecture with a little exercise. How many of you have not taken a standard course in solid-state physics using a textbook such as Kittel, Mermin, and Ashcroft, or something like that? Okay, but almost all of you have taken such a course. Good. So you know the sort of standard scheme of solid-state physics as explained in standard textbooks like Kittel and Mermin and Ashcroft. Now, I want you to point to an object in this room which is well described by such a theory. Yes, okay, good, yes. Probably Jonathan's vacuum flask is, I imagine it's, what, aluminum?
Stainless steel.
Stainless steel, right, okay. Okay, anyone else? Which one? Yep, right. But if you look around, most of the stuff in this room, you had to sort of think about it. Most of the stuff in this room is not described at all by the standard account of solid state physics that is given in standard textbooks. Okay. In fact, most material, most solid material here on Earth, I would claim, is not the usual crystalline stuff, which is the bread and butter of solid state physics textbooks. Most matter is not crystalline; it's amorphous, glassy in some sense or another. This is amorphous. This is amorphous. That is amorphous. This is most certainly amorphous. many of the most important things around us in the real world are in fact amorphous rather than crystalline. So it's a hugely important subject, nevertheless one on which has not, at least until very recently, been the subject of many standard solid-state textbooks. I'm going to give a part of this talk based on my slides. This will basically mostly review some of the ideas which people have already discussed concerning amorphous materials. If this doesn't take the whole 1.5 hours, and I suspect it probably won't, I'll spend the last few minutes talking more informally about some ideas I've been playing around with over the last few years myself with some collaborators, including Project. Let's first of all ask what we mean by a glass and where such things are likely to occur. Here's a typical textbook diagram, the phase diagram of some kind of standard material, like say water. We have low pressures, high temperatures. We have the vapor phase. We're not going to be particularly interested in that. Here we have the liquid phase, and crudely speaking, the liquid phase is characterized by two major properties. First of all, the time averaged density of particles is spatially uniform, and secondly, a liquid by its usual definition can't sustain shear. Here in the standard textbook picture we have a crystalline solid, and for a crystalline solid, if we define the Fourier components of the average, the time average density, then in general we will find that for some non-zero, obviously the zero value of k is non-zero, and that's not interesting, but for some non-zero value of k, namely what we normally call the reciprocal lattice vectors, then this quantity is not going to be zero. So in words then, we have a periodically modulated time average density. And secondly, for a crystalline solid, the shear modulus is non-zero. It takes a finite force to try to shear it. So good. Now the general belief is that in the thermodynamic limit, the ground state of any element or any mixture of elements is either a crystalline solid or In very exceptional cases, it might be a liquid. That was, in some sense, unexpected from a classical point of view, but we do know that the two isotopes of the two stable isotopes of helium, when cooled down to zero temperature, do not appear to form a crystalline solid. They prefer to stay liquid. Now, there is a slight caveat one has to make concerning the sort of relatively recently discovered class of materials which form quasi-crystals. I'm not going to get into that for this particular purpose, but for the overwhelming majority of cases, the ground state is believed to be either a crystalline solid or conceivably a liquid. The second belief, a second general belief, is that if you could cool sufficiently slowly at constant pressure, this ground state would actually be obtained. However, that raises the question, what do we mean by sufficiently slow, and what happens if the cooling is not sufficiently slow? Well, crudely speaking, as to what constitutes sufficiently slow, you might, I think, intuitively expect that this would depend on the degree of complexity, or if you like, awkwardness of the atoms or molecules you're trying to put together. For example, I would expect intuitively that if I were to take some simple rare gas solid, I'm sorry, there seems to be a typo here, this should be rare gas, not non-gas. If I were to take, say, a simple assembly of, say, xenon or atoms or neon and try to freeze them, then it wouldn't be too difficult to get a regular crystal coming out. If, on the other hand, I had some nasty set of biological molecules with all sorts of planes and bits sticking out here and there and so forth, and I try to I try to quench those, then you think intuitively that purely geometrical reasons, it would be rather difficult for them to find a regular crystalline orientation, and therefore they would not form in general a regular crystal if I quench them too fast. And crudely speaking, I think that's generally true. One experiment that I haven't seen a report of, but would be actually rather interesting, I think, is to deliberately try to quench a mixture of different rare gases, say four or five different rare gases, and to see whether that took appreciably much longer to form a regular crystal than did the individual elements in it. I suspect that it would take much longer, but we don't know, I think. And the interesting question for present purposes is what happens if the cooling is not sufficiently slow? So suppose we start now with a normal liquid, and we start to cool it down across the point at which in equilibrium I would get the solid. Well, you all know that even in trivial, sort of relatively trivial cases, everyday cases like water, the water doesn't necessarily immediately form a crystalline solid. We do get at least a certain degree of supercooling, or at least we can get. Whether we do or not depends in practice a lot on what kinds of impurities I have in the system and so forth, but certainly if I'm especially careful, I can get a supercooled liquid. Now, suppose I keep on cooling down, then generally speaking, what will happen is that I will hit what's usually called the glass transition or vitrification. This is, as far as we know at least, the glass transition is not a phase transition in the usual thermodynamic sense. What it is a dramatic change of the kinetic coefficients of the system. For example, you get a huge change in the viscosity. It can be up to 17 orders of magnitude sometimes. Really huge change of viscosity. And crudely speaking, at that point, you say you've got the glass transition. Now, clearly, that's not a very quantitative definition. The exact definition of TG is a matter of convention, and in fact would even depend somewhat on the cooling rate. So the usual convention is to take the glass transition as occurring at the point at which the viscosity is 10 to the 12 pascal seconds, This is not a very familiar unit, but it's a standard SI unit of viscosity, 1 kilogram per meter second. Just for comparison, the viscosity of ordinary water at room temperature is about a millipascal a second. So it's a very, very viscous system. You always find, I think rather trivially, that the glass transition is below the transition, this should be a T sub S here, transition to the crystalline solid, and typically it's of order 0.7, thereabouts, of the crystallization transition. So this phenomenon occurs with a wide variety of materials. Typically, most of the experiments are done on relatively small organic molecules, which are nevertheless quite complicated enough in structure. They have difficulty finding the crystalline ground state. So below the glass transition, then we have what we would normally call glass, or more technically, an amorphous solid. And crudely speaking, the defining characteristics of the glass phase, the amorphous phase, is that for all k not equal to zero, the Fourier component of the time average density goes as some inverse power of the volume. We needn't specify exactly which, but at least that's crudely says that it has no long-range crystalline order. Nevertheless, if I look at the correlations of the density for a given position at different times, then in general that's not zero. Now that, you see, would be different from what happens for a liquid. For a liquid, if I were to plot that quantity, then this average here would just be trivially the average of the total density. In other words, even if I sit at a given position, the density, the time average density, is just the total density. A third property of the glass is that it has a non-zero shear modulus, at least over experimental timescales. The question is quite often discussed in the literature as to whether one should really look at a glass as simply a very, very viscous supercooled liquid. And for a long time, there was an observation which was advanced in favour of this point of view, namely that if you look at the windows of medieval cathedrals, they always seem to be thicker at the bottom than they are at the top. And for a long time, people said, well, this is because, these windows have been around for hundreds of years, and even though the viscosity is incredibly large, nevertheless, there is some finite flow, and they have flowed down in this kind of way. Well, alas, that turns out to be an urban myth, as it were, at least as far as we know. There's a nice paper by Sonato and Gupta in the American Journal of Physics a few years ago, which showed that really, if you actually try to put the numbers in, that can't possibly work. There has to be some other reason why these windows are thicker at the bottom than the top. Nevertheless, that doesn't, of course, answer the conceptual question. Should we really regard a glass as a very, very viscous supercooled liquid or not? But I don't think, in fact, that the answer we give to that question has very profound practical consequences. What we do know for sure is that, as Pradyo was remarking, ergodicity is broken for a glass in the sense that there have to be lots and lots of states which are available to the system, which it is not exploring. In particular, of course, the crystalline ground state. Never, by definition, a glass doesn't manage to find the crystalline ground state, so it can't be fully ergodic. Let's just review a few of the many types of glasses. A very common type is ordinary silicate glass, Si or Gi oxide. Borosilicate glasses, lead crystals, high polymers. This very common type. So when you put a lot of complicated, biological molecules together, in general, they're going to form some kind of glass. There are electrolyte solutions and various other types. Glass is coming in all shapes and sizes, in fact. Moreover, they have all sorts of interesting electromagnetic properties. They can, they may or may not contain, say, electric dipole moments, as in the case of SiO2, magnetic dipole moments in some other cases. It may show ferromagnetism. They very often show so-called spin glass behavior, where the, not only the atomic positions, but also the spins form a sort of disordered array. In some cases, they behave like normal metals. For example, this rather common amorphous metal. You see, incidentally, that this is this contains three different elements, which is one intuitive reason why it has difficulty finding a crystalline ground state. There are even cases, quite common cases, in fact, where glasses or amorphous metals are superconducting. And in fact, there are even some amorphous superconductors which have rather high transition temperatures, like niobium, titanium, and so forth. If we confine ourselves for the moment to non-metallic, magnetic and non-metallic glasses, so we'll explicitly exclude the so-called spin glass problem, although that is a huge problem which has been studied in its own right. But what we're left with basically three major classes of problems which experiments on glasses pose to us. First of all, there's the problem of how the actual glass transition itself occurs, and in particular, why we get the rather reproducible dependencies of things like viscosity on temperature that we appear to. So that's a huge problem in its own right. A second class of problems, which is somewhat related to this, is the question of aging and relaxation effects. That is, there are lots and lots of phenomena in glasses where you get interesting long-time behavior over periods of anything from the order of seconds to the order of years. And it's very interesting to see whether you can find some kinds of regularity, some kind of example, non-exponential power law and things like that. Again, that's a huge field of study. In some sense, when one looks at either of these two phenomena, which are somewhat related, you're really you're looking at the attempts by the system to explore the whole phase space, or at least as much of it as it can in the time available. However, there's a third class of problems which really relate to, in some sense, the region close to the local minimum. So they don't really, in some sense, require the glass to explore large regions of the phase space. It's a much more local problem. And this essentially has to do with the thermal and ultrasonic and also the dielectric properties of glasses. And as we'll see, that is already a major problem in its own right, and that's what I'm mostly going to be talking about in the rest of this talk. Okay, so no other questions. Let me go on to the meat of this talk then, which has to do with the thermal, acoustic, dielectric properties of glasses. Well, let's consider the most minimal picture which we might try to construct for these properties. And this is, the most obvious modification one can make to the standard crystalline picture. You remember that in a typical textbook model of a crystalline solid, you have the atoms sitting at regularly ordered positions in a regular array. They're connected by springs, which are supposed to be harmonic. And as a result, of course, you go through the usual arguments and get out the existence of well-defined harmonic oscillator modes, namely the phonons, the sound wave modes. That theory, of course, is extremely well-developed. So in the most obvious modification in the case of the glass is that your atoms have sort of landed up in a position which is not a regular array, but nevertheless, they're still joined by these springs, which are still harmonic. So in other words, in both cases, you have a Hamiltonian of this type. The structure of the Hamiltonian is essentially the same in the two cases. The only difference is that in both cases, these deviations are measured relative to the equilibrium positions. The only difference is that the equilibrium positions are ordered in this case and disordered in that one. Apart from that, it's exactly the same. So given this, then the Hamiltonian, in both cases, can be exactly diagonalized. Now, in general, of course, you would expect that the properties of the normal modes in this case would not be quite the same as in this case. They would not, in general, be characterized by a definite wave vector, and in some cases, they might be strongly localized. For example, if it turned out that some of these springs had force constants, which are much higher than others, then that's going to give you a vibrational mode which sits away from the spectrum of the delocalized modes in general. So you would expect some non-trivial differences. What would be the consequences of such a model? Well, first of all, you would not expect in such a model any nonlinear effects, provided that, of course, that you the sort of perturbations that you can apply are the usual linear perturbations, which one normally assume. The reason for this is that irrespective of the actual structure of the eigenfunctions and so forth, any set of simple harmonic oscillators behaves in a strictly linear way. That's a very, I trust you're all familiar with that, that property of simple harmonic oscillators. It's what I call the swinging door theorem. If you give a swinging door a small push, it doesn't matter where in its cycle it was. The differential effect of that push is the same, irrespective of the initial amplitude and so forth. And that, of course, is what makes the whole theory of harmonic oscillators so much more simpler than just about anything else. But you would not then expect any nonlinear effects, and as we'll see, that is that's strongly contradictory to the properties of real amorphous materials. Secondly, you would expect a specific heat, which is given by the standard formula for a set of harmonic oscillators. The rho of omega here is the density of states, as a density of vibrational states as a function of frequency. N of omega is the Bose distribution. Furthermore, this is a slightly less obvious consequence, perhaps. In the long wavelength limit, you would expect that the only contribution to this integral is from long wavelength, longitudinal and transverse modes. And these long wavelength modes really should look pretty much like the modes of an elastic continuum. In other words, now this is a slightly more intuitive kind of argument. What you'd expect is that if I'm talking about a really long wavelength phonon-like mode, then all the system should really know about is the average longitudinal and transverse displacement. It should not care about what the individual atoms are doing in detail. Okay. So, but however, you would always get simply a set of longitudinal modes. And since we're talking about a material which can sustain shear, you'd also expect a set of transverse modes. But given that, you would expect that, for example, the velocity of each of those modes individually would be isotropic. There should be no particular direction picked out, as there might be in a crystal. Furthermore, if the only contribution is that, then you can actually count these modes by just counting the number of k's involved. That gives you the standard result that rho of omega goes as omega squared, which of course is the same as in the crystalline case. This then would lead you to expect that, just as in the crystalline case, the low temperature specific heat should have the Debye form proportional to T cubed. We'll see in a moment that's not at all true. You would expect also higher frequency localized modes. Exactly how many and what their characteristics are will, of course, depend on the detailed nature of the solid. There's a rather amusing result one can also obtain from this disordered harmonic model. Let's make the slightly phenomenological assumption that under both compressional and shear stress, the elongation of a given bond is proportional to its original length. Now, of course, that's that may or may not be true in real life, but it's sort of relatively plausible hand-waving assumption. Okay? In other words, crudely speaking, what I'm saying is that when I, for example, try to stretch the system over long distances, then I don't actually change the relative distances of the particles. I only expand everything by the same factor. Okay? And assume that the same happens when I try to shear the crystal. Then it turns out there's a rather amusing little argument which says that under those conditions, you can make a prediction about the ratio of the speed of transverse sound to the longitudinal sound is exactly 1/√3. We being my student Dervish Baran and I sort of came across this ourselves and we were rather amused by it. I have a strong feeling that this was probably proved by Lord Rayleigh sometime back in the 19th century, but we haven't so far been able to find a reference for it. I suspect it's a well-known result, in fact. Anyway, it's interesting that, in fact, if you look at the data, real-life amorphous solids do seem to approximately satisfy this relation to within about 5 to 10%. So it's not bad, really. So to this extent, so in some ways at least, this disordered harmonic model does seem to have a certain amount of validity. In particular, remember prediction four, was that that you get these vibrational modes which lie outside the main continuum, and that would suggest that these modes might contribute extra specific heat beyond the Debye specific heat. And in fact, if you plot the specific heat as a function of versus T cubed, and subtract off the Debye contribution. Personally, I don't believe this is a terribly sensible thing to do, but people, it's conventional in the literature to do this. If you do that, then you find the so-called boson peak somewhere around 1 to 10 degrees. It does look as if something like that is happening. Moreover, something like this does appear to be showing up in the inelastic neutron scattering data. So there is seems to be a certain amount of validity, the idea you do get these localized phonon-like modes. Occur, or lattice vibrational modes occurring in the solid. Also, as I mentioned, 5 was the prediction of the ratio of the speed of longitudinal and transverse sound. That's verified to within less than 10%, generally speaking. So far, so good. Those predictions of the disordered harmonic model do seem to be coming out roughly right. However, as I already remarked, if you believe that model, then in the zero temperature limit, the specific heat should be Debye. And until 1970, this was the, no one had ever really bothered to look, but the general belief was that indeed, if you did take an amorphous solid down to temperatures, let's say well below 10 degrees absolute, and look at its specific heat, then you would find the Debye law. Well, in 1970, Bobby Pohl at Cornell and his collaborators did bother to look, and to their great surprise, they found something quite different, in fact. For almost all, this has now been checked on a huge range of amorphous materials, almost all amorphous solids below about one degree absolute, the specific heat is roughly linear in temperature, so much larger than the Debye value. Much larger, orders of magnitude larger. And as I say, it's roughly linear. It's usually fit to a power law, which involves something like 1.2 to 1.3. In fact, I think that's almost certainly misleading. I would bet my bottom dollar that you could almost certainly fit the experimental data equally well to T times log of something over T, provided that you allow T0 to be different for different materials. Remember, it's very difficult by looking at data over a limited range to distinguish a small power law like 0.2 to 0.3 from a logarithmic behavior. I would bet if and when we get a final verdict, as it were, on the amorphous materials, the specific heat is going to be that rather than that. I have to say, you know, this is not in some sense, a politically correct subject. I mean, glasses are not glamorous. They're not like the Higgs boson or anything like that. And moreover, they're very messy in many ways. So you know, you have to have a rather special interest in these things to spend a lot of your time doing experiments. Luckily, there are a number of groups throughout the world, though most of them are not in North America these days, but in Europe and Japan and elsewhere, there are quite a few groups who are doing these experiments. Okay, what this indicates, I think with a fair amount of degree of confidence, is that there have to be extra low-lying degrees of freedom apart from the long wavelength phonons. In other words, there has to be something which is in some sense much more localized and therefore can't be counted with a K in the same way as the long wavelength phonons have. A further very interesting observation, which is somewhat associated with this, is that, and this was also done originally by Zeller and Pohl way back in 1970 or thereabouts, is that if you take the raw data on the thermal conductivity of an amorphous solid, plot it on a log-log plot, what you always find is that the low temperature region here below about, starting at 1K or a little below, such that in this region, the thermal conductivity is approximately proportional to T squared. Again, it's not exactly T squared, it's T minus beta, and crudely speaking, the beta which occurs there appears to be close, at least, to the alpha which occurs in the specific heat. Then it turns out that between about 1 and 10 degrees, you almost always get a so-called plateau where the thermal conductivity is either flat or only slightly rising. And then again, at high temperatures, again you get a behavior which crudely, it's a little difficult to define here because by now you're getting up towards the glass temperature. But crudely speaking, again, it appears to be proportional to T squared. Now, a few years ago, quite some years ago now, my colleague Andy Anderson at Illinois and his student Justin Freeman decided to look at this a little more closely. And they actually did a sort of scaled plot of a kappa. They scaled it with an appropriate function of the putative Debye temperature of the glass, and plotted it versus T over theta D. And what you then find is that basically you still get this graph, but it's much, much more universal. In particular, both the low temperature and the high temperature data collapse onto a single line in such a graph. Interestingly, the plateau does not collapse. The plateau is different for the different materials. Now, what does this imply? Well, at least for the low temperature region, high temperature regions one not quite so sure, but at least for the low temperature region, it's pretty much, I think, well established that thermal transport is entirely or mainly by the phonons. There's a nice experiment by Zeitlin and Anderson, again, this is my colleague at Illinois, way back in 75, where they actually deliberately punched holes in their system, worked out the scattering cross-section for the appropriate phonons. So if this is right, you see, if the thermal transport is entirely or mainly by phonons, then what this data is telling you, you remember that there's a sort of standard formula for the thermal conductivity, which involves the specific heat. This is, in this case, the specific heat of the phonons, which is something you know. It involves the phonon velocities, which again you know directly, and it involves the mean free path. So this is telling you something about the mean free path of the phonons, what it tells you is that at least for those the thermally important phonons, the ones with H omega over the order of kT, the mean free path is always about 150 times the actual wavelength of the phonon involved. You convert this into a high frequency Q factor for your phonons, that says it's independent of frequency, and roughly 3 times 10 to the minus 4. This is roughly consistent with direct measurements of the ultrasound absorption, or more likely, we'll see they're related, of the ultrasound velocity. So everything appears consistent with the idea that there does seem to be this rather universal Q factor for your phonons, certainly in this low temperature regime. And if the thermal conductivity is also by phonons in the high temperature regime, which seems at least probable, although not certain, then again that says that up here, L is of the, essentially equal to lambda. So if you like, Q is then of the order of one. Okay? So this is really quite fascinating and quite puzzling. Okay, so these data have been around essentially since 1970, and very soon thereafter, a couple of groups independently developed what is now known as the tunneling two-level system model of what was going on in glasses at low temperatures. And this is now 40 years old, and it's basically has become the established model in the field. So I'm going to spend the next few slides reviewing the basics of that model. So the general idea is that because the material is amorphous, there are likely to be atoms, single atoms or groups of atoms, which have not a single equilibrium position, but two equilibrium positions which are not too far apart, equilibrium or quasi-equilibrium. So if I just think of the potential felt by a single atom in a glass, because the glass is disordered, it'll have maybe a deepest minimum around here, but then fairly close by, there may be another minimum over here. And you would expect that, well, because it's officially high temperatures, you might expect the atom to activate, to thermally activate across the barrier, to go from here to here, and that might perhaps be relevant to the glass transition, but that's not something we want to discuss. At low temperatures, you still might have the possibility of quantum tunneling between these two positions. So imagine for the moment that's all, and you just focus on a single one of these atoms, with that is a single two-state system. So it could be an atom, it could be something more complicated, like a molecule or even a group of molecules. We don't know. Let's take as our basis for writing down the Hamiltonian, the two sites here. Then obviously there's a diagonal term here. Actually, I guess the difference, this isn't terribly well drawn, the difference between the minima should actually be 2 epsilon and not epsilon. So I have an epsilon here and a minus epsilon there. I have, and if necessary, I'll put a half in front of it. That's just a matter of convention. Then I have some tunneling matrix element, delta, between these two, which obviously is off-diagonal in this representation. And so if I can trivially diagonalize this rather simple Hamiltonian, I get the eigenvalues plus or minus, possibly a factor of a half, times root epsilon squared plus delta squared. Now, interesting question is, what's the density of states of this these two-level systems? Because remember, that's going to be what determines the low temperature specific heat, presumably, if indeed this is all that's going on. Well, technically, the density of states is given by this should be a d epsilon, I guess, d epsilon d delta, the probability of getting a particular value of epsilon coupled with a particular value of delta, times this delta function here. That's the formal expression. So what we need is the probability that a given two-state system has a particular value of epsilon and a particular value of delta. Okay, so at this point, the TTLS model starts making a number of assumptions. You'll see that it makes a very large number of assumptions, and this is only the start. The first assumption is that essentially the dependence on epsilon is independent of the dependence on delta, no correlation between these two, which seems crudely, intuitively reasonable. Second postulate is that the distribution of epsilons is more or less constant. Again, that seems vaguely reasonable because there seems no particular reason, as it were, why epsilon should have any particular positive or negative value. If it's negative, well, that doesn't make any difference in this formula here. So it seems reasonable that, in some sense, this minimum should not know a lot about the existence of this minimum here and should just be distributed uniformly. Now, delta is a little more tricky. Delta, is, crudely speaking, you'd expect to be given by some kind of prefactor times the WKB exponent for tunneling through this barrier. Now, at this point, the two-level system TTLS model usually makes the assumption that rho, that the variable lambda is the WKB exponent, is uniformly distributed. That's not at all so obvious why that should be the case, but and in fact, if you start to vary that, you can get different outputs for things like the specific heat and so forth. So again, it's not obvious that the height of the barrier is not connected, is not correlated with the epsilon here. So you know, a fair number of fairly fudgy assumptions that go into this, but let's just see what happens if you make that simplest possible assumption. Then, in fact, because of the structure of this expression, it turns out that the distribution as a function of delta is proportional to delta to the minus 1. In other words, you get very large, you get a large probability of getting very small values of the tunneling matrix element delta here. Now, if you plug that into your expression for the density of states, lo and behold, what comes out is the density of states comes out to be constant as a function of energy. And in the literature, that constant density of states, that assumed constant density of states per unit volume is usually denoted P bar. Okay, well, so what does this buy for you? Well, if that's the case, then, well, basically, remember these two state systems are essentially analogous to the occupied and unoccupied states of fermions and so forth. So, it's as if you had a set of fermions with a constant density of states relative to the Fermi energy. The algebra is essentially the same, and what you find is that the specific heat is given by this formula, and you can easily substitute variables and so forth and find that that varies as T. So that's approximately as the experiment. Of course, it's not exactly as the experiment, and there are ways of trying to fine-tune the assumptions about the distributions of lambda and so forth to make that come out. But by this time, you become conscious that you really are doing an awful lot of adjustment, as it were, an awful lot of fudging to get the experimental results. What about the ultrasound attenuation? What does this model say about that? There's a very nice piece of work done by Josef Jekyll way back in 1972 in his thesis, which is actually published here, which basically is a sort of pretty complete description of the account of the whole problem of ultrasound attenuation and velocity within the TTLS model. Generally speaking, in the canonical basis, the two-level systems are going to couple to the strain field through both their sigma z and sigma x degrees of freedom. Let me just go back for a moment. So you have these two-level systems. What's going to be the effect of a sound wave? Well, let's imagine, for example, a compressional, a longitudinal sound wave, which compresses the material. One thing it's going to do is possibly to change the height of this minimum relative to this one. In the language of in this basis, this is going to be a so-called sigma z effect. It's going to be a term in the Hamiltonian, which is proportional to the strain and also proportional to sigma z. But in addition, the sound wave is going to modulate the barrier height here, that in turn will change the tunneling matrix element. So that'll be, in this notation, it'll be a sigma x type of term. So you get both of these. So, so what this will tend to lead to is, first of all, the absorption of ultrasound, that is the absorption of phonons, and also, of course, spontaneous phonon emission, and which would lead to relaxation of the two-level system. So a typical, for any particular tunneling two-level system, the actual rate at which it relaxes is going to be a function of all the parameters involved, so it's going to be quite messy, but typically, it's going to be a function of the energy, and crudely speaking, proportional to I guess E cubed cos E over kT, and therefore effectively a function of temperature. Okay, so you can say something then about how you might expect the various absorption and emission properties to depend on temperature. And in the literature, in Jekyll's thesis and the following literature, there occur two major regimes. First of all, we have the resonance regime, where the frequency of the phonon is large compared to the relaxation time of, let this be the relaxation time of the typically thermally excited two-level systems. So that would mean E of the order of KT. In this regime, the main effect is the absorption of ultrasound by direct excitation of the two-level systems. Well, since the... Now, it's not immediately obvious how this is going to go. You have to be careful about the ways in which the phonon frequency comes into the matrix elements, etc., etc. But what turns out, actually, if you do the calculation properly, turns out that at zero temperature, the inverse Q factor is independent of frequency and given by the following formula. Apart from an overall numerical factor, it involves the mean square coupling to the strain, the average density in per unit energy of the two-level systems, and then two factors which you know directly, the density of the solid times the velocity of the phonon in question squared. And let's call that the high frequency Q factor. Now, in fact, it's rather difficult to measure the high frequency factor, Q factor, directly experimentally. Remember that you, as Jonathan was saying, typically you go down to temperatures of the order of 10 millik. That means that you're working in the sort of low gigahertz regime, and for various practical reasons, it isn't easy to do experiments for much frequencies much higher than that. So crudely speaking, you're usually restricted to h bar omega less than or of the order, at most of the order of kT. And there's really only been one set of experiments to my knowledge which has even probed h bar omega of the order of kT, and that's by Golding and Graebner way back in the 70s, in fact. Again, there are any number, as always in this field, as I said, it's not a fashionable field. If there were thousands of experimentalists interested in it, then an awful lot of experiments one would like to see done, but there just haven't been enough people around to do them, basically. Anyway, so let's look at what happens at finite T, or if you like, lower frequencies. Under those conditions, you need to consider both the absorption of a phonon by a two-level system, but also the stimulated emission. So when you put those together, it turns out that now reduces the inverse Q factor. At a given omega and T, it's now proportional to Q to the minus 1 tanh omega over 2T. In some ways, a more interesting question relates to the velocity shift. The velocity shift follows from a Kramers-Kronig relation relating the velocity to the absorption. And the Kramers-Kronig relation is this form, and if you just stare at that and work it out, it turns out that what this means is that you get a logarithmic term in the velocity as a function of temperature. And the coefficient of that logarithmic term is predicted to be exactly this high frequency Q factor. Now, indeed, this is exactly what you see experimentally. You do see exactly such a logarithmic term, and from it you can read off the Q factor. And as a matter of fact, in most of the, when experimentalists quote values of this beast, it's most often from these velocity measurements rather than from the direct absorption measurements. The second regime is the so-called relaxation regime, which is omega tau much less than one. Under these, and that regime, the absorption is actually of a rather different nature. What happens there is that it's mostly by modulation of the two-level system energies, followed by a relaxation to the new thermal equilibrium distribution. Okay. So this is rather typical of what goes on, quite rather generically, in the hydrodynamic regime in solids, in solids or liquids. Basically, what's happening there is that you're changing the parameters rather slowly. The system is trying to relax itself, and in particular to relax its thermal distribution to keep up with the changing parameters. It nearly succeeds, but not quite, and what's left over is essentially contributes to the relaxation, the dissipation of the ultrasound energy. Now, the theory is actually rather considerably more complicated over much of this regime, but what is interesting is that within the TTLS model, you get a very simple result. Namely, in this regime, the inverse Q factor is again a not only a function of omega, it's not even a function of temperature, and it's simply a half the value in this quite different resonance regime. That's quite a remarkable result of the TTLS model, actually. And there's no, as far as I can see, there's no very simple way of seeing why that comes out. But anyway, it does seem to be the prediction. Now, there is an intermediate regime, and there, Q to the minus 1 drops below its limiting, the two limiting values. We already know, however, that the high frequency inverse Q factor is about 3 times 10 to the minus 4. And so we can make the statement that within the TTLS model, I mean, assuming we take this from experiment, okay, within the TTLS model, the absorption can never be greater than that. So this is a rather interesting statement one can make, and it does seem to be, as far as I know at least, consistent with all existing experiments. You may sometimes find that the inverse Q factor of an amorphous material is less than this standard value. You'll never find it to be greater. I think that's entirely consistent with existing experiments. And this is really a rather small number, you see. Not a order of one, by any means. It's really rather puzzling. What about the thermal conductivity? Well, this will go as CV. I don't think the squared should be there, actually. Times the mean phonon velocity times the mean free path. Now, if Q is constant, that means that the mean free path is inversely proportional to frequency and therefore inversely proportional to T to the minus 1. The specific heat here is the phonon specific heat, which is T cubed. So if you put those together, you predict that the thermal conductivity is proportional to T squared, roughly in agreement with the experiment. So far, everything seems to be in rather good agreement with experiment. And there's one other thing one should just mention, sort of qualitative a feather in the cap, as it were, of the TTLS model. As soon as this model was evolved, people immediately started to realize, we've got a lot of experience of dealing with two-state systems in quantum optics, in NMR, and so on and so forth. We can basically take over all the law from there and predict all sorts of interesting nonlinear effects, for example. So we can predict that we'll get saturation of the ultrasound absorption for a sufficiently large amplitude. We can predict we'll get echoes, we have that so-called hole-burning effect. A whole gamut of things that you see in quantum optics and NMR and so forth. Okay? And these predictions were made ahead of time, and sure enough, they did turn up in the actual experiments. So it looks right now, at this point, as if the TTLS model is doing pretty well. So it does make all these confident qualitative predictions. All of these things were seen experimentally. And if you are prepared to take an appropriate, adequate number of fitting factors, and you often have to take quite a lot, then you can actually fit the data quantitatively. So what could be wrong with the TTLS model? First of all, in most glassy systems, you really don't have any clear microscopic picture of the nature of these two-level systems. There are one or two cases where we do seem to have a reasonable picture. A particular example is potassium bromide, potassium cyanide mixtures, where the cyanide molecules can basically orient themselves one way or the other relative to their host, the potassium bromide. And it does look as if those two orientational states could form the basis of a TLS model in that particular case. And there have been quite nice comparisons of experimental theory, which do seem to work roughly for that particular material. But generally speaking, we really don't have any clear picture. And remember that, as I say, these materials can be of almost arbitrary chemical composition, almost arbitrary microstructure, and so on and so forth, ranging from anything, for example, from simple compounds like lead oxide in its amorphous phase, all the way up to these complicated polymer solutions. And they all seem to have these. If you believe the model, they all have these two-level systems. It's not easy to see why. The second thing, which I've already brought up, is that there's, at least in its original form, the TDLS model simply doesn't claim to give any explanation of the higher temperature phenomena, for example, the plateau in the thermal conductivity. Again, you might think, and we will in fact see later, that there is a you can't really treat the two different two-level systems as independent. There has to be an interaction between them. How far is that expected to change the basic predictions of the model? But I think the thing which is really, to my mind, the most striking criticism of the TTLS model as it stands is the following. You remember that we had this high-frequency Q factor, which we could actually find experimentally. Interestingly, in some cases, it's read off from the low temperature resonant regime. In other cases, probably the majority by now, it's read out from the overdamped relaxation regime. But in both cases, experimentally, it seems to be within a factor of 2 of this number, 3 times 10 to the minus 4. Now, why is that a problem? It's a problem because in the original TLS model, the inverse Q factor is made up of 4 factors, each of which fluctuates independently between materials by something like a factor of 5 to 10. Now, assume that these quantities were indeed independent and calculate the probability of getting things within this window by such a model. You see, it's essentially 0. So, okay, sure, you can. I mean, it's not impossible to explain this data within the TTLS model, but you have to invoke an extraordinary degree of coincidence, a really extraordinary degree. And that's what's always bothered me about the model and which has been obsessing me for the last 25 odd years. So basically, that was the account I wanted to give of the standard TTLS model. Now I just about to spend the last few minutes just talking qualitatively, without too many view graphs, without slides, about an approach which I've developed in collaboration with my former student. This should be Viral, Devish Chand Viral, and we actually published a single paper on this last year in the Journal of Non-Crystalline Solids on this. Okay, so here's the basic philosophy. Suppose we start with phonons. We know the phonons are there for all sorts of considerations. So basically the phonons are just long wavelength elastic continuum excitations. Suppose we have some arbitrary other degrees of freedom which are subject only to a single requirement, namely they don't have a simple harmonic oscillator spectrum. That's much more generic than the simple two-state model. It'll cover a much wider variety of possibilities. The effects of these objects is encapsulated, first of all, in the effective Hamiltonian for the system when it's subjected to zero strain. And secondly, what I've got to know is the way in which the Hamiltonian changes when I impose a small strain, for example, due to a long wavelength phonon. And that, by definition, is given by the stress tensor, this beast here. So the Hamiltonian, then, consists of the initial Hamiltonian of my objects. Dervish likes to call them defects, but I don't really like that name. I think they're just some unspecified degrees of freedom other than the phonon. Let's just call them objects. We have the Hamiltonian of the objects, the usual elastic continuum Hamiltonian for the phonons, and then we have a coupling between these two. Now, the coupling to the strain field will give rise to a stress-stress interaction of this form here. The interesting point is that I think it's a reasonable conjecture that at large length scales, everything is going to be dominated by the interaction term. I'll show you in a few minutes a slightly more quantitative reason for thinking that that's true. If that's true, you should forget altogether about thinking about the individual, even if you happen to start with tunneling two-level systems, as it were, you're stage zero. And it's a special case. I should say that the tunneling two-level system model is a special case of our approach. It's a possible implementation, even if you started with these two-state, these independent tunneling two-level systems at your zeroth order stage. Nevertheless, the coupling by means of virtual phonons will give rise to this 1/r³ interaction between them. So very crudely, you expect a coupling which is proportional to g/r³, where g is proportional to γ²/ρc². Gamma, remember, is the effective coupling to the strain. Rho is the density, c is the velocity itself. If you assume, let's do this, for example, on the basis of experiment, if we assume that your density of states is roughly constant as a function of energy, then essentially on dimensional grounds, it's got to be proportional to, first of all, to inversely to g, but also it's got to be inversely proportional to the number of mediating modes. That's crudely speaking, because you would expect that the density of states is inversely proportional to the strength of the interaction. The strength of the interaction is going to control the distance between levels, so the density of states is going to be inversely proportional to that. Now here comes the interesting point, you see. If that qualitative argument is right, then the inverse Q factor is given by this factor here, which is just G times P bar, but P bar is 1/ng, so the G cancels, and you're just left with the n to the minus 1. So what this argument would tell you is that you would indeed expect q to the minus 1 to be universal, and moreover, you'd expect it to be inversely proportional to the number of modes which are mediating the interaction. Okay? What you're using here is a very fundamental point. The phonon whose absorption you're actually measuring in the experiments on q to the minus 1, which defines q to the minus 1, it's the same object as is mediating the interaction between your two-level systems. So it's sort of natural that you should get some universality. Moreover, when you calculate the interaction, you're exchanging all possible phonons, but you absorb only a single branch of phonons. Therefore, by that argument, the q to the minus 1 should be proportional to n to the minus 1. Now, you see, that looks at least somewhat promising because, it does give you a universal result. The only question is, do you have enough phonons, as it were? N is not a large number in our case. N is only 3. Okay? However, then you console yourself with the fact, yes, okay, but it's interacting with a lot of stress tensor components. There are 5 independent stress tensor components. So that gives you 15. So getting in the right sort of general direction. It turns out one can give sort of hand-waving arguments as to, well, one can certainly try to pin down the point below which this simple r to the minus, the value of r, the distance below which this simple r to the minus 3 form will not work. And it turns out that you can actually write it in terms of the parameters of the model. You try to make a rough estimate of what that would correspond to when expressed as a phonon wavelength, work out the number. Then you ask, okay, at what kind of temperature does that correspond to? In other words, at which temperature would this would phonons have this kind of wavelength? And surprisingly, the answer turns out to be just about 1K, which is exactly where the plateau in the thermal conductivity starts. So that at least indicates there might be something there. Now, I'm going to have to go through this rather quickly, but I'll just try to describe roughly what we've done. We've basically tried to implement this model more quantitatively, and what we find is, well, first of all, we give a general scheme, and if I had, what we basically do is to start with, okay, so we start with essentially this Hamiltonian here. We divide our system into large blocks and average over the blocks, as it were. So we now have stress tensor operators for each block separately. And of course, these stress tensor operators are bilinear tensors. This quantity lambda ijkl is a nasty anisotropic mess, which I could write down but won't bother to, it's so nasty. We know what it is, however, in fact. So now, basically, what we do is we start by assuming certain kinds of properties of the individual blocks. We then take into account this interaction to try to calculate the renormalized density of states, and moreover, the renormalized absorption of the superblock made up by putting these blocks together. And, we can sort of write down the program for doing this. Alas, we are dealing by hypothesis with a very, very random disordered system. So to actually make this work quantitatively, we would really need an incredibly large computer. So we can't do that. And there are two possible approaches we're trying. One I'm doing with Prajo, where we're trying to look to see whether applying the general theory of random matrices is going to give us some insight into this problem. The other one is a sort of pseudo-analytic approach, which I took with Dervish. And there, what we've basically done is to make what we hope are minimal assumptions about the structure of the matrix elements and so forth, and try to carry out this, given that, try to carry out this renormalization process analytically. So basically, we've at each length scale, then, we've got these blocks, which are of size, which are some characteristic size L. We've got this 1 over R cubed interaction between them. Now, remember that in three dimensions, 1 over R cubed is rather special. It's, in some sense, it's scale invariant. So what you would expect intuitively is that, in some sense, the problem should look similar at all length scales. Or, put it slightly differently, that we should renormalize, possibly, to a unique fixed point as we go to large length scales. We do seem, given rather crude assumptions which you make about the structure of the matrix elements and so forth, we can, in fact, demonstrate that that's what's occurred. And what we, in fact, find is something like this. We find that at if we go from one length scale to the next length scale up, as it were, then Q out to the minus 1 is equal to 1 over Q in to the minus 1 squared plus K, and I'll explain K in a moment, to the 1 half. I think when we next write this up, we're going to use a different symbol for Q to the minus 1, because the minus 1 is a nuisance and keeps confusing things. So this is what happens. If we start with a block of size L, say, and then put together several of these blocks to form a super block of size, say, 2L. So let's go 2L. So put 8 of these together. And this is the kind of result we get. You see that this term is always less than this term here. And if K is large, then it'll be dominated by this term here. Moreover, we'll see that as we go to longer and longer length scales, we can iterate this, as it were. And at the end of the day, we come out with something like this calculation, incidentally, is for the average Q, not Q to the minus 1. I'll say in a moment what we mean by that. So 1 over Q in, or Q naught, this is the starting value here, to the minus 1 squared, plus K log R over R naught, all to the half. So Q bar, what I mean by Q bar here, is the Q factor average over a rather large frequency scale. Now you see what's interesting, well, several things that are interesting. Q minus 1 is always less than the starting value of Q naught to the minus 1. Moreover, R is the length scale at which I'm looking. So in practice it would be the wavelength of the phonon I'm trying to absorb. R0 is some microscopic length. What's very interesting is you see that this tends to zero as the wavelength goes to infinity. So what this is making is a rather remarkable prediction that if I were to measure the wavelength of sound in the limit that the temperature goes to zero and the frequency also goes to zero, I would actually get zero. Okay? However, it only goes to zero very, very slowly. It goes as 1 over the square root of a logarithm. So but not surprising that even if that effect is for real, it has not been seen in existing experiments. So far, so good. If we put in now values of R which correspond to the actual measured frequencies of the order of a megahertz or thereabouts in real life, we can actually estimate what Q0 minus 1 is. It's small, but it's not that small. It's about 0.015, and that's about halfway, as it were, logarithmically, to the value we would like to get. So we're missing something there. And what we're missing, I believe, is that we've assumed that the Q factor was uniform over a wide frequency range. Now the next bit is really very tricky, and I'll just try to describe it in a sort of hand-waving kind of way. Okay, let's do the most obvious thing we can do, which is simply to take this Hamiltonian and do perturbation theory in the interaction. Okay. The nice thing about doing that is that when you sort of write this out in gory detail in terms of the matrix elements squared and the energy denominators, et cetera, it turns out that you can write the result of second order perturbation theory uniquely in terms of the actual chi of omega, that is the actual absorption, the stress-stress correlation function, which is essentially the absorption. What you find is something rather peculiar. If you just look at the result literally, it looks as if this interaction is actually not spreading the energy levels out, it's scrunching them up together. That's precisely the opposite of what you want to explain the experimental data. Okay? But now, Dervish had a brainwave at this point. He said, well, look, we should not take this seriously, because after all, this is a level, you know, you've got the problem of a Hamiltonian. You start off with given Hamiltonian, with given energy levels, you're considering the effect of a perturbation. It looks as if the perturbation is pushing these levels together. Well, let's take that seriously. The levels eventually go right through one another, okay? And if the perturbation is strong enough, what you're actually going to get is a final density of levels. It's much less than the original density, not much greater. So I thought at the first sight this is a completely crazy argument, but eventually I realized one has to really take it seriously, I think, and this probably is what happens. So what that then implies is that indeed the perturbation, or the, well, interaction, not the perturbation, it's actually a strong interaction, will spread the levels out. And moreover, one can also work out that it'll spread them out in a way which thins them out more at the bottom end of the spectrum than at the top. In other words, if you start off with a constant density of levels, the one you end up with is 1 over log E, where E is the energy, and so it's much thinner at the lower end than it is in bulk. And when we've waved our hands enough, and we do have to wave our hands somewhat, and taken that effect into account, lo and behold, what we find is that indeed, in fact, Q minus 1 is not a constant, it goes as 1 over log omega. Which seems perfectly consistent with the experimental data, in fact. Moreover, that in the experimentally accessible region, it indeed comes out very close to that canonical 3 times 10 to the minus 4. There are variations. It's not a unique number. However, I should just make a brief digression at this point. We were not the first, or the only ones. I think we may have been the first, but we're certainly not the only ones to notice this extraordinary coincidence of the absorption, the dimensionless absorption. I mean, it's a problem which has been sort of known about for quite some time now, and there are dozens of papers in the literature which claim to try to explain this. Almost without exception, there is one exception, what they do is simply to postulate that there are certain microscopic properties of these amorphous solids which are, in some sense, uniform. In no case is this something you can get out of experiment. In our case, it's different. We do find a spread in the values, but the spread depends only on two things, which we can in fact measure quite directly, namely the ratio of the velocity of sound, and as I say, that's very close to 1 over root 3 for just about all materials. And secondly, the ratio of the measured transverse and ultrasonic absorptions. Again, something you can measure directly. So we can actually and the scatter there is precisely the kind of scatter that you get in the actual number for Q. So we do think that this at least is somewhat more, on somewhat firmer ground than most of the stuff that's in the literature. However, I should say we found great difficulty in trying to push the arguments beyond the rather sort of hand-waving and phenomenological level at which we've gotten so far. And this is something we're certainly trying to work on rather hard right now. Let me just show you my final view graph, which has a slogan on it. And the slogan is that crystals are the anomaly and glasses are the norm. And I really think that that should be our approach to solid-state physics in the 21st century.